Investigation into the high school massacre is slow moving and dangerous. The two gunmen who went on the rampage booby trapped the building and even themselves. All day long, investigators have searched the homes of both teenage killers. In one of them, police say they found bomb making materials. Specially trained officers searching the school today found close to 30 explosive devices all around the building. Authorities have also revised the death toll, now saying 15 people were killed, including the two gunmen. Most of the bodies are still inside the school, but families of the murder victims have been notified.
Jefferson County 911.
Yes, I am a teacher at Columbine High School. There is a student here with a gun. He has shot out a window.
Hey, YouTube. Welcome back to my channel. My name is Blue, and I'm a police officer in Miami with 10 years of experience. Here, we'll be talking about all things crime, from serial killers to mass shooters to anything and everything else crime-related, all with my experience and perspectives as a cop. If you've been to the channel before, then you know we just started a new series on active shooters, starting with last week's video on Charles Whitman, which you can watch here. Today, we'll be going over the school shooting that changed America, as well as the police response to these shootings, and that's Columbine. We'll be going over what led up to the shooting, the shooting itself, and critiquing and analyzing the police response that followed. And finally, we'll end by going over all the possible times this horrific murder spree could have been stopped. As always, let's get into it by starting with a brief background of our subjects. Eric David Harris was born on April 9, 1981, in Wichita, Kansas, to father Wayne Harris and mother Catherine Harris. Harris's father was an Air Force pilot, and his mother was a homemaker. The family would move to New York before finally settling in Littleton, Colorado, when Wayne retired from the Air Force. Harris would attend Ken Carroll Middle School, where he would first meet and become friends with Dylan Klebold. Dylan Bennett Klebold was born on September 11, 1981, in Lakewood, Colorado, to parents Tom and Sue Klebold. Both parents raised Dylan and his brother as Lutherans, and both sons were named after poets. Dylan's family would be described as pacifist, meaning by definition they were opposed to war, militarism, or violence. Early on, there were some warning signs that these boys were troubled. Harris would run a blog, originally used for his video gaming hobby. This blog eventually took a darker turn, and would be a place where Harris detailed and documented his minor crimes and rebellious acts against his parents. This includes sneaking out of the house, random acts of vandalism, and lighting illegal fireworks with Klebold. Nothing, though, that many teenage boys would not do at least once. These blog posts had turned to angry rants, detailing Harris's anger and hatred against society. Around this time, he was also including posts on how to make bombs. In August of 1997, Harris would end one of these rants with the following. "All I want to do is kill and injure as many of you as I can, especially a few people, like Brooks Brown." Brown, who was a classmate, was told about the post, and upon telling his parents, the Jefferson County Sheriff's Office was notified. It was later discovered that they had written a warrant to search Harris's household, but for whatever reason, this was never submitted to a judge, and nothing further happened with this case. Let's get into their first arrest. On January 20th, 1998, both Harris and Klebold were arrested for burglarizing a van and stealing computer equipment and power tools. At their court appearance, both pled guilty to a charge of felony theft, and, as is still a very common practice, would be entered into a juvenile diversion program. These programs basically take all the consequence of committing a crime away, and instead put the juvenile offender in classes such as anger management. The idea is that juveniles are better served by programs that try to find the reason they commit the crimes and give them the tools they need to not engage in criminal activity again. In my own personal, real-world experience, this is a terrible program for anything but first-time offenders, and is often grossly overused. Just after this, Harris quit posting his angry thoughts for the world to see, and began to keep a journal. Here, I'll display a page taken out of it, dated November 12th of 1998. In it, Harris rants about being a proud racist, how much he loves the Nazis and their form of government, and mentions that if he had gotten more compliments, this whole thing might have been avoidable. He then immediately follows that up with, "but probably not." In his journal, Harris mentions the month of April, and how long it's going to be to hold out until then. He also goes on and on, stating his desire for revenge against all the people that would make fun of him to his face. Also in his writings were mentions of his desires to rape, torture, and cannibalize a woman. In Harris's yearbook, Klebold wrote about killing enemies, blowing up stuff, and killing cops. "My wrath for January's incident will be godlike. Not to mention our revenge in the commons." There are a few different theories as to what the January incident is, as it's believed by many that this played a big role in motivating them to commit these acts. One such theory is that after both boys were arrested, they wanted revenge on the sheriff's office. Another theory, put forward by Brooks Brown's father, Randy Brown, is that the comment refers to two different incidents. In one, both Harris and Klebold are alleged to have brought marijuana to school, prompting school authorities to do a search of them and their belongings. This is reported to have embarrassed and angered them. The second refers to an alleged incident in the cafeteria, referred to as the Commons. According to Brooks Brown, people surrounded them in the Commons and squirted ketchup packets all over them, laughing at them and calling them homosexual slurs, Brown says. That happened all while teachers watched. They couldn't fight back, they wore the ketchup all day, and they went home covered with it. Both Harris and Klebold would plan out and talk about their excitement about the massacre in their journals. Klebold in particular has a page with Times, talking about setting off explosives and positioning himself to shoot the survivors, ending the entry with the words, "Have fun." While in school, both Harris and Klebold would write papers and poems about guns and violence. In one instance, Klebold wrote a short story about a man killing high school students. This understandably unnerved his teacher so much that she reached out to his parents. But as we know, there was likely little done about this, just as there was little done to investigate the alleged written threat against Brooks. In the months leading up to the shooting, Harris and Klebold would acquire two 9mm firearms, one a high-point 9.95 carbine used by Harris, and the other a Tech-9 pistol used by Klebold. The Tech-9 had a 52, 32, and 28-round magazine. The carbine had over a dozen 10-round magazines as well. In addition to this, both were equipped with shotguns, Harris having a Springfield 67H, a pump-action shotgun, and Klebold being equipped with a Stevens 311D double barrel. Both barrels had been illegally shortened to make them more concealable. We'll get into how they obtained these firearms in a little bit. The level of preparation that Harris and Klebold took prior to this shows that they truly had no doubts, second thoughts, or regrets. This was a long-standing plan, and something both looked forward to. In total, the pair would construct 99 bombs, 76 of which would be found or used at the school. On April 20th, 1999, Harris and Klebold would begin to put their plan into action, with their hearts set on causing as much chaos and destruction as possible. What follows is a disturbing timeline of their actions as put forward by the Jefferson County Sheriff's Office. This day, perhaps more than any other day before it, was the day we realized schools are not safe. Harris and Klebold arrive at Columbine at approximately 11:10 a.m., parking on opposite ends of the school. This gives them a view of the main exits of the cafeteria, which leads to an open outside area. It would later be revealed that their intention was to detonate bombs in the cafeteria and shoot the students in the ensuing chaos. Harris tells a student who he sees outside to leave the school for the day, as Harris likes him. This student leaves, and several witnesses would verify this information later to police. Harris and Klebold enter the cafeteria carrying two large duffel bags. Computer modeling substantiated by field testing indicated that had those two large 20-pound propane bombs detonated with a cafeteria full of students, most would have been killed or severely injured by the resulting blast and subsequent fireballs. There were approximately 488 students in the cafeteria at approximately 11:17 a.m. on April 20th, the time the bombs were set to detonate. In addition to the casualties caused by the explosions, the computer models demonstrated a strong likelihood of structural damage and partial collapse of the cafeteria and possible library above. Harris and Klebold returned to their cars, expecting the bombs to detonate, flushing the survivors outside where they planned to gun them down. At 11:19 a.m., Jefferson County Dispatch receives a call regarding an explosion in a field that is approximately 3 miles away from the school. This explosion was planned by the duo, who set it up in the hopes that police and firefighters would respond there first, tying them up and buying the killers more time at the school undisturbed. Back at the school, Harris and Klebold are still standing in the parking lot, waiting for the bombs to go off. After several minutes pass, at approximately 11:19 a.m., witnesses report that they heard the pair shouting, "Go! Go!" while rushing into the school. While rushing, they begin shooting at any students they can see outside. The first to fall victim to the two cowards is 17-year-old Rachel Scott, who was shot several times by Harris using his carbine, with the fatal shot hitting her in the left temple. Rachel was eating lunch on the grass with her friend Richard Castaldo, who was also shot but would survive. Harris and Klebold continue their murderous push into the school, next encountering Danny Rorbo, Sean Graves, and Lance Kirkland. The three boys were on their way out to eat when they were all shot numerous times. All three of them collapsed to the ground. Five more students, also sitting outside on the grassy area, are shot at as they begin to run from the pair. As they run, Michael Johnson is shot in the leg and the jaw, but is able to keep running, taking cover in a shed. Another student, Mark Taylor, would be shot in the upper back and leg, collapsing to the ground. Mark lies there, unable to move, and would be shot several more times, a total of 8 rounds hitting him. Mark somehow managed to play dead, staying alive until an officer would drag him away to safety. Klebold, who had walked away, returns to an injured Danny, shooting him again at close range, killing him. Lance was also shot again at close range, but would survive his wounds. Klebold then enters the cafeteria and stares at the duffel bags containing the bombs, likely wondering why they never detonated. At the same time, Harris had begun shooting again, this time hitting student Anne Marie multiple times in the torso while she ran for cover. Anne would lie there, paralyzed by a round that had struck her spinal cord until she was eventually rescued. At this point, both Harris and Klebold seem to be reveling in their murder spree. Witnesses state that they heard one of them shout, "This is what we always wanted to do. This is awesome." As they walk around the school, they are seen lighting and throwing what would be later identified as pipe bombs around the school. All of this has taken place in approximately 4 minutes. Just 4 minutes. At approximately 11:22, the school custodian observes a commotion via surveillance video. He calls for the school's community resource officer, Jefferson County Sheriff's Deputy Neil Gardner. At 11:23 a.m., a call is finally placed to 911 to report the shooting, and even then, all that is reported is that a female is down in the parking lot of the high school. Deputy Gardner, already responding, activates his lights and sirens and continues on. 11:24 a.m., several of the school's custodial staff and faculty, including teacher William Dave Sanders, are attempting to find out what is happening outside the school cafeteria. Realizing the danger, Sanders and school custodians John Curtis and Jay Galantine enter the cafeteria and direct students to get down. Students begin to hide under the cafeteria tables. Deputy Paul Smoker, a motorcycle officer, is nearby on a traffic stop when he hears the report of a female down in the parking lot. Deputy Smoker advises he is responding as well to the school. Teacher Patricia Patty Nielsen is working as a hall monitor when she hears a commotion outside the west entrance of the school. She looks outside, seeing two male students with what she thinks are toy guns, and assumes that a school video production is being taped. She is on her way outside to tell the boys to knock it off when one of the gunmen fires into the west entrance, causing glass and metal fragments to spray into the hallway on her. Beside Nielsen is student Brian Anderson. Brian had been told by a teacher to get out of the school because of the explosions and commotion. Not realizing where the danger is, he exits through the first set of west doors and is caught between the interior and exterior doors when Harris fires at the doors in front of him, shattering the glass. Both Nielsen and Brian suffer only minor injuries from the glass and begin to run away into the school library. Harris and Klebold were thankfully momentarily distracted from pursuing the pair by the arrival of Deputy Gardner, who, with a bright yellow shirt and marked police vehicle with lights and sirens activated, could not be a more visible target. Harris turns and fires 10 rounds at the deputy before his gun jams, at which time Gardner fires back at Harris with 4 rounds. Harris fixes his gun malfunction and continues shooting at the deputy before running into the school. Gardner, taking cover behind his car, calls for backup. Deputy Smoker, alongside fellow Deputy Taborski, begin to rescue 2 wounded students lying near the ball field. Harris begins to shoot at Deputy Smoker from the school, and Smoker returns fire with approximately 3 rounds, forcing Harris to retreat and disappear back into the building. At this point, Harris and Klebold are now wandering the halls of the school, shooting randomly at students and even down empty hallways, as students report hearing the rounds impacting lockers. Officers outside are still hunkered down as they follow the procedure of the time, which is to set up a perimeter, hold what you have, and wait for the SWAT teams to respond. Student Stephanie Munson exits a classroom, oblivious to what is happening. When she does, she sees a teacher and several students running toward them, shouting, "Run, get out of the building." Stephanie begins to run with another classmate, and while running, is shot in the ankle, but incredibly is able to keep running and get to safety. Let's go back to Dave Sanders and the two janitors, John Curtis and Jay Galantine. 3 of them were able to evacuate an estimated 100 students, risking their lives to make sure the kids were safe. At some point, Sanders encounters one of the shooters in the library hallway and attempts to turn around and run back when he is shot in the head, neck, and back. Sanders, still alive, is able to crawl into the corner of the science hallway, where a nearby teacher, Richard Long, helps him down the hallway into classroom SCI-3. A group of students, including 2 Eagle Scouts, Aaron Hansey and Kevin Starkey, gather around him, tending to his injuries and administering first aid. By this time, Deputy Gardner has radioed a code of 1033, which is his department's code for Officer Needs Emergency Assistance. Because of this and the reports of the violence at Columbine, multiple agencies are responding and setting up a perimeter around the school, while attempts are made to evacuate both the injured and uninjured. Reports have also come in from students and officers on scene of possible hand grenades being used, due to the explosions being heard throughout the school. At 11:27 a.m., teacher Patty Nielsen advises dispatchers that a gunman is just outside of the library, and she can be heard telling students to get down and hide under the tables. Around the same time, outside multiple students are being evacuated, and descriptions are finally being given of the 2 shooters. Deputy Gardner requests medical to respond to the west side of the school, where they will be staging with the injured. This is where the most lives that were lost could have been saved, if officers had pursued Harris and Klebold after engaging them. What happened in the library was one of the biggest reasons for this change in police tactics, and we will see just how many lives were lost because the tactics of the time were to sit and wait for SWAT, rather than enter the school. At 11:29 a.m., Harris and Klebold enter the library, where one of them can be heard yelling, "Get up!" to the students he can see hiding under the desk. When no one does, Harris fires his shotgun at a nearby desk, the shrapnel of which hits student Evan Todd in the eye and back, fortunately sparing him further injury. The pair then encounter Kyle Velasquez sitting near a row of computers. Kyle, who was developmentally challenged, was well known to students and was one of the many victims who reportedly had never bullied or harassed Harris and Klebold in any way. Now in the library, Klebold and Harris seem to have a ridiculous amount of time to do what they want. They mock and taunt the terrified students before firing down at police from the second floor windows. Police return fire, and the pair take cover and back away. At this time, Klebold fires his shotgun at three students hiding under a nearby table, injuring Patrick Ireland, Daniel Stapleton, and Mackay Hall. At the same time, Harris walks towards a row of computers and, taking a knee, fires a single point-blank shot from his shotgun, fatally hitting 14-year-old Stephen Kernow in the neck. Harris then fires at 17-year-old Casey Rugsager, hitting her in the right shoulder and severing an artery. Amazingly, she would survive this injury. Harris then walks on to another table with two students hiding underneath, Cassie Bernal and Emily Wyatt. Harris allegedly kneels down and yells out peekaboo to the hiding pair, before shooting Bernal in the head with his shotgun, killing her. After this, Harris turns to student Bree Pascal, who was no longer hiding under the tables. Bree pleads for her life, and Harris laughs in her face. Reportedly, Harris refuses to kill her when prompted to by Klebold, advising him, "We're gonna blow up the school anyway." Klebold would notice Patrick Ireland attempting to help an injured Mackay Hall. Klebold shot Ireland again, this time hitting him in the head and foot. Patrick is knocked unconscious from this, but would actually survive these injuries. Klebold goes back on the move, looking under another table where he discovers 18-year-old Isaiah Scholes, 16-year-old Matthew Ketcher, and 16-year-old Craig Scott. Witnesses report that Klebold and Harris began to taunt Isaiah, calling him numerous racial slurs, before Harris ultimately shoots him in the chest, killing him. Klebold then shoots Matthew once, killing him moments later. Scott would survive by playing dead under the table. Harris then throws a small bomb known as a cricket back at Patrick, Daniel, and Mackay, which landed on Daniel's leg. A quick-thinking Mackay grabbed it and threw it away from them just before it exploded. Harris and Klebold begin to wander around the library, before Harris shoots 17-year-old Mark Hinchin in the head and shoulder. Harris then turns around suddenly and randomly fires at a table, striking three 18-year-old students, Lisa Kreutz, Lauren Townsend, and Valine Schnur. Klebold then approached Lauren and shoots her several times with his Tech-9, killing her. At this point, Valine begins to scream, "Oh my God, oh my God," in shock repeatedly, before Harris and Klebold mock her and ask her if she believes in God. Valine responds yes, at which time Harris and Klebold walk away from her. Reportedly, Harris and Klebold would ask this question of several students, some of who they killed and others who were spared. Harris moves on and fires at two other students, 16-year-olds Nicole Nallon and John Tomlin, injuring them both. Klebold then repeatedly shoots a crawling John, killing him. Harris would continue on, returning to another nearby table. Here, he shoots a 16-year-old Kelly Fleming, hitting her in the back and killing her. He shoots repeatedly at the table, hitting and wounding 18-year-old Jana Park. The shooters move to the center of the library, where they reloaded their weapons at a table. Again, they have all the time in the world. Harris then points his carbine under a table, but the student he was aiming at moves out of the way. Harris turns his gun back on the student and told him to identify himself. The student says he's John Savage, who is an acquaintance of Klebold's. He asked Klebold what they were doing, to which Klebold shrugged and answered, "Oh, just killing people." Savage asked if they were going to kill him. Klebold stated no and told him to run. Savage flees, escaping through the library's main entrance and through the cafeteria. After this, Harris turns and fires his carbine at the table directly north of where he had been, hitting the ear and hand of 15-year-old Daniel Mauser. Mauser tries his best to fight back by either shoving a chair at Harris or grabbing at his leg. Harris fired again and hit Mauser in the center of the face at close range, killing him. Harris then moves south through the library and fired three shots under another table, critically injuring two 17-year-olds, Jennifer Doyle and Austin Eubanks. Klebold then shoots once, fatally wounding 17-year-old Corey DePooter. There were no further victims. In approximately 7.5 minutes, 10 students are killed and a further 12 are wounded. At 11:36, Harris and Klebold exit the library. Cautiously, fearing the shooters' return, 10 injured and 29 uninjured survivors begin to evacuate the library through the north emergency exit door. Casey was evacuated from the library by Craig Scott. Had she not been evacuated at that point, she likely would have bled to death from her injuries. Patrick Ireland, unconscious and thought to be dead, remained in the building. Patty Nielsen crawled into the exterior break room and hid in a cupboard. For the next about 30 minutes or so, Harris and Klebold begin to exchange. They're both seen wandering around the school, randomly shooting into empty classrooms, setting fires, and throwing pipe bombs into unoccupied areas. At one point, Klebold is seen actually approaching one of the propane bombs that failed to explode, appearing to examine it before walking around the cafeteria. Klebold made one last attempt at setting the bomb off by throwing a Molotov cocktail at it. This didn't detonate the propane tank, but rather ignited a gallon of fuel that had been attached to it. This, however, was quickly extinguished by the sprinkler system. They would leave the cafeteria at approximately 11:46 a.m., wandering the halls and randomly shooting into the ceilings and walls. It was reported that several times they were seen looking into rooms where students and teachers were hiding, but strangely enough, did not try to get in or shoot them through the doors or windows. The pair seemed to be aimlessly wandering and almost appeared to have given up. At 12:02 p.m., Harris and Klebold returned to the library and began to once again shoot at officers, who were still outside. The officers returned fire, but just as in the past instances of exchanging fire with police, neither party was injured. At 12:08 p.m., Dylan Klebold went down to his knees and shot himself in the left temple with his Tech 9. Eric Harris sat on the ground and fired the shotgun through the roof of his mouth at the same time. Finally, the madness was over. Dylan Klebold and Eric Harris no longer existed in this world, and they could no longer take innocent lives. From the time they had entered the school to the time they took their own miserable lives, less than an hour had elapsed, approximately 49 minutes. Yet the damage and destruction they left in their wake would change America as we know it. So let's take a bit and talk about how the police responded from this point on. Police SWAT teams would not enter the school until approximately 1:09 p.m. that day, with snipers positioned on nearby buildings and multiple SWAT teams on scene to assist in a search of the 250,000 square foot school. Police finally enter and begin to evacuate survivors who are either injured or barricaded in classrooms. Now, this response was widely criticized in the media and by the public as not having been fast enough. Let's take some time, and I want to use my training and experience to talk to you guys about why that response was so slow, and what considerations the police had to make while responding. Firstly, let's talk about the standardized training that most departments followed for events of this nature. If you saw my last video, you know that Charles Whitman and his killing spree, widely considered the first mass shooting, changed police tactics forever. In Charles Whitman's case, police did respond and engage in a reasonable amount of time, for the time period that it was in, but they're totally outmatched by superior positioning, firepower, and training. Police SWAT teams were formed largely as a response to this previously unheard of type of massacre. Something else to remember, guys, police work is reactionary. The training, techniques, and equipment don't often change until the need for those things is recognized. Just like in human nature, we tend to fall into the mindset that what has worked will always work. I say that to say this. After Charles Whitman, the standard procedure in policing was in the event of a mass shooter to hold a perimeter to make sure the shooters are contained, hopefully minimizing damage and the loss of life, and to await the SWAT team response. The SWAT teams were better trained, better equipped, and had the firepower that the traditional patrol officer just did not. Now, that's just one reason the officers stayed out of the school, but there were many other considerations to take in. For instance, officers had been shot at and were initially overwhelmed at the scene. As the first deputy responded to what was a woman down in the parking lot he was shot at and began to notice that some students were running for cover, while others were lying injured in the area. The deputy returned fire and was soon backed up by two other officers. His backup began a rescue attempt and began to take fire from the shooters themselves. Now, as more and more students would come out, the reports of multiple shooters spread. In a short time, the reports were up to 8 different shooters were active in the school. Another consideration was the loud explosions and reports of hand grenades going off. Officers at the time had no gear that would allow them to safely withstand something like that, and so the officers followed their training at the time, which was to wait for more backup and the eventual SWAT teams. I cannot stress enough what an absolutely chaotic nightmare this scene was, and only those who have ever been a part of one or worked in the emergency services would be able to even understand a fraction of what it must have been like. The mass crowds, the misinformation about multiple shooters, the gunshots and explosions nearly constantly ringing off, the injured and the dead lying all around you, and all this was made worse by what must have seemed like a never-ending list of complications that would come up. Reported early on in this incident was a possible sniper on the roof of the school, further delaying rescue efforts. In actuality, this was a worker on the roof, who upon hearing the shootings, barricaded the roof hatch and stayed there until he was rescued hours later. However, this caused a lot of confusion for responding officers and students, and once the word spread that it was a sniper, it was not easy to ignore that. On top of this, officers are coordinating the rescue of the injured on the outside where it's possible, evacuating students who are making it out of the building, organizing a triage area and attempting to get medical there, and relaying all new information coming in by the students who are giving it. They're also having to provide suppressive fire for periods of time while the medics and officers attempt to treat and remove the injured. Deputy Gardner, one of the main deputies on scene himself, is working to evacuate 15 students, one at a time, using a line of cars as cover to evacuate them safely. At 12:14 p.m., approximately 6 minutes after Harris and Klebold take their own lives, dispatchers are still being advised of multiple shooters inside rooms 1, 2, and 3, with multiple injured parties inside. You cannot blame the students and teachers for these inaccurate reports. As a matter of fact, in many cases of mass shootings or even gang-related shootings, witnesses in the chaos believe they see or hear more shooters than are actually present. And in a case like this, rumors spread like wildfire. This just further complicates the rescue efforts. On top of this, a large number of police officers are being positioned around the school to block all traffic except for emergency vehicles. Once multiple SWAT teams actually enter the building, they're met with more challenges, further slowing down the rescue efforts. For a period, dispatchers are entirely overwhelmed by a huge volume of calls due to a local news station reporting that those who know their children are okay should report it to the Jefferson County Sheriff's Office. While the team is entering, a live bomb is located, forcing them to back out and enter at a relatively safer point, a window in the teacher's lounge. Let's take a second and imagine the scene. The team is met with the deafening noise of fire alarms, the flash of the strobe lights, ceiling tiles hanging at odd angles, and 3 inches of water coming in under the closed door to the cafeteria. The alarms and the sprinkler system have been set off by the explosions, and the cafeteria area and adjacent rooms are flooding. Another concern is a hissing sound and the sound of something spraying. The team leader, Williams, fears it might be a broken natural gas line, a fear further amplified by the fact that it's known the shooters were using explosives. There is no telling what kind of booby traps might be lying in wait. On top of all this, the floor plans of the school they're using to determine how they're going to clear it are outdated, not showing an entire wing of the school that was added. It's about as bad as a situation as you can possibly walk into. Despite this, the SWAT teams press on. It's been too long already, and they are determined to save who they can. Back outside, more distractions arrive. 3 students show up on scene, all dressed in black. Because of the descriptions that are being given out, the boys are detained. Also around this time, a teenager with a rifle showed up on scene to help officers, and he was also detained. Inside again, a group of 60 students is found inside an auditorium and evacuated bit by bit as the SWAT officers use themselves as cover for the students. Patrick Ireland, despite his extensive injuries, is seen by outside officers attempting to crawl out of a second-story window. SWAT members, using their armored vehicles, were able to climb up and finally rescue Patrick from this nightmare. As the building is eventually cleared, the bomb squad is called out, just as officers receive word that bombs were also found at the Harris residence. Finally, at 4:45 p.m., the teams had just finished their hours-long initial search of the school. Those teams would then swap out with other SWAT teams for an hours-long exhaustive secondary sweep. Remember the teacher we mentioned earlier, Dave Sanders? At approximately 2:15 p.m., students who were helping him placed a sign in the window that read, "One bleeding to death," in order to alert police and medical personnel of his location in the science room. Police, however, initially feared it was a ruse by the shooters, but their approach would have been delayed anyway, which I'll explain shortly. At 2:30, this sign was spotted, and by 2:40, SWAT officers evacuated the room of students and called for a paramedic. The 2 students who were helping Sanders were reluctant to leave him behind. By 3 p.m., the SWAT officers had moved Sanders to a storage room, which was more easily accessible, as they awaited medical personnel. As they did so, a paramedic finally arrived and found Sanders had no pulse. He had died of his injuries in the storage room, likely long before he could receive medical care. He was the only teacher to die in the shooting. Now, even if the sign had been spotted earlier, the SWAT officers would still not have been able to get to Sanders without clearing the rest of the school on the way to him to make it safe. For starters, Sanders was not the only one injured, and officers knew this. Secondly, if they just rushed to that sign, they would be risking numerous casualties, potentially setting off a bomb or booby trap that they had good reason to believe were present. Clearing a building with potential shooting suspects inside is an outrageously slow process, even with a team full of people. That process becomes even slower when you add in the environmental setbacks that we discussed earlier, as well as the reported presence of explosives. In the days following the shootings, Rachel Scott's car and John Tomlin's truck would become memorials, and impromptu memorials were held in Clement Park. On April 30th, carpenter Greg Zanis erected 15 6-foot-tall wooden crosses to honor those who had died at the school. Daniel Rorbo's father cut down the 2 meant for the gunman. There were also 15 trees planted, and he cut 2 of those down as well. I'm not sure who was in charge of planning that, but it is sickening to even think Harrison Klebold would get a memorial of any kind. In major tragedies like this, the number of deaths can increase as the toll of what happened wears on the survivors. These are the ones who are often forgotten about, so I'd like to include them here. 6 months after the shootings, Anna Marie's mother commits suicide. Several former students and teachers would be diagnosed with PTSD, although I'm not sure who wouldn't after an event like this. Greg Barnes, a 17-year-old student who had witnessed Sanders' shooting, goes on to commit suicide in May of 2000. Survivor Austin Eubanks, who was injured during the shooting, would develop an opioid addiction after being heavily medicated for his injuries. Eubanks would eventually pass away from an accidental overdose in 2019 at the age of 37. So what did we learn? What changed? Today, we have something at our disposal called an RPO, or Risk Protection Order. A Risk Protection Order is a firearm-related temporary ex parte order, or a final order meant to enhance public safety by temporarily preventing individuals who are at a high risk of harming themselves or others from assessing firearms or ammunition. This is just the definition, without getting into the arguments for or against them on either side of the aisle. However, even using this measure would likely not have helped here. Harris and Klebold were not known to have firearms, but even if that earlier search warrant we spoke about had been served, that was in 1996, and they would not acquire these weapons until November of 1998. Let's actually talk about how they got the guns in the first place. On November 22, 1998, their friend Robin Anderson purchased a carbine rifle and two shotguns for the pair at the Tanner Gun Show, as they were too young to legally purchase the guns themselves. After the attack, she told investigators that she had believed the pair wanted the weapons for target shooting and denied that she had prior knowledge of their plans. Anderson would not be charged. Harris and Klebold both held part-time jobs at a local blackjack pizza. Through Philip Duran and Mark Maines, two of their co-workers, Klebold would buy a Tech 9 handgun for $500 at another gun show on January 23rd. After the massacre, Philip Duran and Mark Maines were both prosecuted. Each was charged with supplying a handgun to a minor and possession of a sawed-off shotgun. Maines and Duran were sentenced to a total of 6 years and 4.5 years, respectively, in prison. Like we discussed earlier, police followed a traditional tactic at Columbine: surround the building, set up a perimeter, and contain the damage. That approach has been replaced by a tactic known as the Immediate Action Rapid Deployment Tactic, which is a name that has changed about a dozen times as years have passed. This tactic calls for a four-person team to advance into the site of any ongoing shooting, optimally a diamond-shaped wedge, but even with just a single officer if more are not available. Police officers using this tactic are trained to move forward to the sounds of gunfire and neutralize a shooter as quickly as possible. Their goal is to stop the shooter at all costs. They are to walk past the wounded victims, as the aim is to prevent the shooter from killing or wounding more. It has been said that the active protocol has proved successful at numerous shootings. It has also been said that at Virginia Tech alone, it probably saved dozens of lives. We'll get into that in a future video. This tactic relies on the regular, run-of-the-mill patrol officer to be trained and equipped to be able to respond to events like this. Now, if this tactic had been used here, I believe that many lives could have been spared. None of us can see the future, and it's very easy to look back after an event and criticize. But it is very likely that if this had been done, one of two things would have happened. One, the shooters would have killed themselves. The FBI statistics have told us that in about 80% or so of cases, when a shooter is pressured by an officer who is engaging with them, they will kill themselves. And two, Harris and Klebold would either have had to take cover in a classroom or other room, and because the officers are engaging with them and advancing, they likely would not have had the time or ability to shoot officers. As an example, take a look at what happened in the library, where most of the casualties occurred. Harris and Klebold had a ludicrous amount of time to kill and injure all those students, while taking breaks to shoot at officers and reload their weapons. While the police did return fire, it was abundantly clear that they were not coming in, giving the killers all the time they could want. Today's tactics would have seen the officers pursue the shooters, not giving them any time to think or wander around the school, like we saw them do before they took their own lives. There is so much that could be said on this topic, guys, but my hope today was to give an overview of the shooting, and to try and talk about the police tactics and the changes that came as a result of this tragedy. In my future video on the series, we will be seeing where these tactics have saved lives. I do not want to offer a blind defense of the police, but hopefully just more insight into the challenges they faced and how we can learn from our failings to improve. I know the series is pretty dark, as was my last one, but hopefully you're all enjoying the content. If you have any suggestions on a mass shooting you'd like to hear about from my perspective, leave it in the comments. And as always, stay tuned and stay safe.